www.ahc-oakland.org.
Good afternoon. This is KPFA or KPFB in Berkeley or KFCF in Fresno at 88.1. We're also online at kpfa.org. Coming up next, it's about health with our host, Joy Moore.
Good afternoon. Good Monday afternoon to you. This is Joy Moore. I'm filling in for Dr. Lenore. And today we are going to talk about my pet peeve. I've been on this subject for 30 years. Finally got some light last month. Federal Drug and Administration had some hearings about petroleum in our food, food additives. If you eat anything that's colored or preserved or flavored, pretty much the base of that chemical is petroleum. And I have two exciting guests that are going to join me today. We're going to talk about all things additive to our food, food additives, food petroleum products, how we can avoid them, what is the solution, and we're going to offer some great premiums. So stay tuned. I'll be right back. All right. Thank you again. This is Joy Moore. So today is a little special and about health. We're not going to do any call-ins. This is fun drive this next few weeks. So we're going to keep it on topic. We're going to speak with our guest. The first guest who's going to join us by phone is Jane Hersey. She is the National Director of the Fine Gold Association. She and I have been working on this together for several years. She's been on the show several times. And I want to welcome her to the show. Hi, Jane.
Hi, Joy. Thank you so much for inviting me back. I love being with you.
And today we're also going to be joined by Shua Edelkind. She is also with the Fine Gold Association, and she hasn't quite made it to the phone, but she's going to be joining us in a few minutes. But she attended the FDA hearings and actually testified. Is that true, Jane?
Yes, she did. And Shula is one amazing woman. She literally taught the scientists many, many things that they did not know about these studies. Studies on hyperactivity, or what's now being called ADHD, and food additives, specifically food dyes, have gone on for several decades. But what she pointed out was things that the researchers didn't really know and didn't think about, mistakes in the study design, limitations in the design, and she really blew them away. So
okay.
I'm excited for her to be joining us.
All right. We waited for her. She's caught in traffic, but she's going to get with us. So now let's start at the beginning, so because I don't want to assume all of the audience has heard this story before, although I don't see how they could miss it. I've only done it once every year for the last 6 or 7 years at least. But let's just start with the Fine Gold Association. I myself have told the story, and I want to share it again. My family has been afflicted with a super sensitivity to petroleum products. We discovered this in the 70s, and I read a book called Why Your Child is Hyperactive and the Hyperactive Cookbook, which was written by Dr. Feingold, who was an allergist at Kaiser Permanente in San Francisco. And he had estimated, this was in the 70s now, he estimated that 3 million children at the time were going to be misdiagnosed with having some kind of hyperactivity disorder, but really all they had was an allergic reaction or sensitivity to petroleum products.
That's right. People look at these children and say, gee, what's wrong with the child? And I look at what the child's eating and say there's a very high probability that there's nothing wrong with the child, but there's a whole lot that's wrong with what he's eating.
Right.
And so sometimes the answer is literally right under their noses on the dinner plate or in the cereal bowl that they're having for breakfast.
Now, what's so curious to me and disturbing, I actually watched a television show. I'm laid up now, and I'm just happy to be able to watch TV, which I hardly ever do. But Dr. Phil had a family on where the child was out of control. He was 8 years old, and they were giving him medication. They were restraining him. They were thinking about putting him in an institution, and they came up with all these solutions and resources, and not once, once did anyone mention the possibility that his diet was causing him trouble.
Right. You know, we run into this an awful lot, Joy, and I think what people are thinking, they look at a child with horrific problems, and they assume that you need a huge, terrifically big solution. They don't understand that sometimes a very big problem can have a very small solution.
Right.
How about lung cancer? Well, don't smoke. You know, that's a fairly simple thing. Not easy, but
no,
simple.
But yeah.
Simple to do, and yet it can make an enormous difference. Well, what we found, and we've been doing this now, this is the 35th year that the Feingold Association has been doing this work, and I can tell you that, as you well know, we wouldn't do it if it didn't work. What we have found is that sometimes these horrific problems can have a relatively simple solution, and that is humans are not designed to eat toxic chemicals.
Yeah.
Such as food dyes. When you take them away, very often the change is profound. And another thing, Joy, the more severe the child's problem is, in many respects, the easier it is to do this because everybody is so highly motivated, and especially the child. These children do not want to be out of control. Mm-hmm. And when they understand that it's as simple as eating the lollipop mommy gives them instead of the lollipop that they get from the bank or the barbershop, it can make a world of difference. And again, we've got 35 years of successful experience that we're relying upon for this.
Okay. Now, the other thing, too, is a lot of people misdiagnose. Well, let's go back.
Yeah.
Some people are aware of this. And in fact, England and Europe label these products or ban the use of these products. So there is an awareness of this.
Absolutely. And it started in England. And I really have to give so much credit to Jamie Oliver, who is going to be on TV tomorrow night on his next show. And he was the one who first got people to realize what horrific things they were feeding children in the school cafeterias. And then that was followed by another wonderful event in England, the latest study from the University of Southampton, showing that not only are so-called ADHD kids affected, harmed by these food dyes, but what we call regular kids, that the average child, when he eats something like yellow number 5, red number 40, blue number 1, that almost any child will be affected. It's just that it might take more of the additive before you see an effect.
Right.
It's very much like a medicine. The dose of a medicine is very critical.
Yes.
So some people have a very minor effect. Some people have a very major effect from the same dosage.
Right. And that's one of the things that confuses people. I think we pretty much know there are a lot of things that we can do that are toxic to us. For example, if you get lead poisoning, then the symptoms are the same. They affect people pretty much the same.
Mm-hmm.
But this seems to have something different in that different kinds, different amounts, different products, different levels of sensitivity makes the symptoms different.
You're
so it's difficult to... all right, let me just say who we are. This is Joy Moore. I'm filling in for Dr. Lenore. This is About Health. We're speaking with Jane Hersey. She's the National Director of the Feingold Association. She's joining us by phone from Virginia. And we're also joined on the phone by Shula Edelkin. And she is the Director of Research for Feingold Association. And she actually testified at some FDA hearings last month. Welcome, Shula.
Hello. Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us. So Jane and I were just discussing our past history together of how we came together. I was telling the story of how my daughter was diagnosed when she was 5 years old. When she started school, it became an issue, her behavior. You know, I was a single parent, first-time parent. So I had a child who was out of control, but I had nothing to compare it to, so I didn't know she was out of control. And so when she started going to elementary school, it became apparent that she wasn't able to do any of the things other kids were doing. And they sent me to a doctor, and the first thing he wanted to do was give me Ritalin to control her seizures. She was having seizures, petite mal seizures. And this is an extreme symptom of the sensitivity to the petroleum, but she was having them, and they didn't know why, but they want to prescribe her Ritalin, which actually had artificial color, artificial flavor in it. And so it was just fortunate, very fortunate, that I resisted that. And I came home one day, and Dr. Feingold was actually on the television on an old show called Donahue Show that I don't think exists anymore.
Right.
And he was describing the symptoms, and the descriptions sounded like my daughter. So I got the book, Why Your Child is Hyperactive. And from that day to this, we've been very conscious, very particular about what we eat in terms of any food, particularly if we go out or to other people's house. We're always trying to eat whole processed food. Now, having done that story, I know both of you are parents and both of you have similar experiences, but I want to jump up now to the FDA hearings. The FDA site, I went to the site, and they've always contended that there may be a problem, but it wasn't, it only affected a small amount of people. Is that true?
That's what they said. Yeah, but I, Shula, don't you agree that it wasn't until very recently that the FDA even consented that maybe this was a problem? My recollection is that for all of these years, the FDA has been saying, no, there's no link at all between food dyes and hyperactivity or ADHD. And then all of a sudden now, oh, well, yeah, maybe some kids are affected.
Right.
But, of course, the research shows that it's much more than that. But anyway, Shula, why don't you, you're the expert here. Let me defer to you.
Well, they always hedge their bets by saying that perhaps there were some unusual children that were allergic or that had some, you know, they were peculiar and their peculiarity made them react to these colorings. But then again, people can react to anything. So they was always kind of like a they covered themselves like that. One of the things that encouraged this attitude, I think, was because many of the early studies on food dyes with children used very tiny amounts of food dye. They would put the children on a diet, and about 70% of the children generally got better. So they would take some of these children that were better, and they would challenge them with, you know, 5 milligrams, 10 milligrams, 20 milligrams of food dye. And this is similar to doing an experiment with aspirin. Let's see if aspirin cures your headache, and we're going to give you a half a baby aspirin. Well, you know, if you're a 200-pound man,
yeah,
this is not going to cure your headache.
Exactly.
And then they're going to say, oh, well, aspirin doesn't work except maybe on some small children.
Right.
And that's exactly what they said, because they did find reactions on the smallest of children, you know, in 3-year-old children or even some 4 or 5-year-old children, usually very few of them as well. And so the typical answer then, and this became the official state of the art, reports that only some few very small children, very young children, were affected, as though when you turned 5 or 10 or whatever age they decided, some switch would close and you no longer could possibly be reactive to the colorings. But like you were saying, it's definitely dose related. But more than that, it's if you consider the colorings similar to medications, which they are chemically similar to medications, what's called a low molecular weight chemical.
Mm-hmm.
You know, medications have side effects.
Right.
And side effects vary. Any one particular medication will list side effects like headache and insomnia and stomach ache and diarrhea and earaches, and hyperactivity is often a side effect of various kinds of medications. Well, and other people have no side effects. They have no problem with the medication,
mm-hmm,
or their side effects are not problematic. They're they're minor. Well, here again, some people have very serious side effects of the food colorings, and others have much less, unless they're taking a lot of it. Like maybe they'll only have a problem on Halloween when they've eaten their whole pillowcase full of candy.
Right.
And then again, it you know, the sugar doesn't help any, but it's mostly the artificial colorings and flavorings that are in there that are the biggest problems. So it's both dose relationship and it's the individual sensitivity to what these chemicals are in the way of side effects. Now, if you're taking a drug because you're sick, you may have to tolerate some side effects. There is no reason to put medications in your food.
Exactly. And that's what we, that's what's so insidious about this now. The food processing industry in this country is already very duplicitous. If you try to determine how much sugar or fat is in your processed food, it's very difficult. They have this secret formula, if you will. They tell you the serving size, and then they'll give you how much sugar is in the serving size, and then they'll tell you a small bag is 6 servings or something, and and you add it up. And it's the same kind of thing now. It's like it's as if the FDA is actually protecting the food industry against their own criminal acts.
I think they do know that
this food is harming us. They do know. And how do we know? Because now if you go to the store, a lot of processed foods will charge you a premium for taking additives out. It says no additives, but we're going to charge you more money. Now, where did that come from?
Well, you know, this is capitalism, and capitalism has its downside. Of course, it has plenty of positive aspects to it, but capitalism works best when you have the vested interests of the industry on one side, you have the consumer's best interest on the other side, and what you're supposed to have in the middle is the referee. The FDA is supposed to be the agency that keeps an eye on what goes on in the food industry, the chemical industry, the pharmaceutical industry, and the FDA is supposed to be working for the consumer. Well, it worked fairly well up until a few decades ago when things started to fall apart, really in the beginning of the 1980s.
Under Reagan.
Yes.
Deregulation.
Absolutely. Deregulation. That was the magic cure. Similar things happened in England under Margaret Thatcher, where industry was allowed to, quote, police itself. Well, you know, that's like saying to a 3-year-old, you know, you can decide what you eat, what you wear, and when you go to bed. That's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Of course, the industry is going to operate on what is best economically for them. So, The system isn't working anymore, and the agencies, not just the FDA, I include many federal agencies, are either working for the industry or, and in many cases, we believe they're working against the consumer.
Mm-hmm.
So it's all that much more important that the consumer is aware of what kind of things are going on. And the good news, I think, is there's so much a consumer can do to protect themselves. For example, one of the things that we do in the Feingold Association is to research actual brand name foods, and those which meet our specs,
we'll do the video right after this.
Additives, we publish books listing thousands of brand name foods that are okay. This is just one of the things that a consumer can do, because when you go into that supermarket, what you decide to put in your grocery cart will have enormous impact if enough people stop buying the fluorescent cereal or the neon orange mac and cheese. It's going to disappear from the shelves, and the healthy stuff will be there instead.
Right. That is the voice of Jane Hersey. She is the National Director of the Feingold Association, and we're also joined by Shula Edelkin. She's the Director of the Research for Feingold. Shula, let's jump to the FDA hearings. Now, I know we don't, I got very excited when I heard there were hearings. I didn't expect much to happen from it, but I was excited that there was at least some light being shined on this issue on a national level, and that we hopefully could get a little bit of press. It wasn't much. It was just a blip. But tell us about your experience, and what do you think we can hope to come from it?
Well, first of all, we have to realize we were not talking to the FDA itself. We were talking to an advisory committee, and these were outside experts. They were epidemiologists, toxicologists, psychiatrists, of course, there were the industry representatives as well, and everybody had their say, both the committee and the people that were addressing the committee. I was impressed that most of the committee members seemed to be very earnestly trying to understand the field. I think many of them didn't have a lot of background in this. They were open-minded. They asked very good questions. Some of them did. In fact, there was one gentleman who had actually done research, and when one of the other committee members was quoting his research, he said, look, I hate to tell you that that research is wrong when it's my own, but it is 30 years old.
Mm. Yeah.
And so I'm not sure exactly which piece of research it was, but I remember the comment, and I thought, that's an admirable man.
Hey, we need to get his name. What's his name?
I have to look it up.
Okay.
But in any case, they were so sure. I believe they really were so sure in the committee that they were going to recommend warnings being put on the labels of foods. They were having a big argument about what they were going to say on the label and the wording and, you know, and how long it should be. I mean, they were going into great detail. And as it happened, they were really only one vote short of having a tie.
Wow.
So this would have sent a very strong message that they believe that there was a problem. And unfortunately, some of the message that did get printed was, oh, the FDA says it's safe. You know, being one vote short of saying we need warning labels is not saying it's safe.
No, it isn't.
They know there is a problem. Where they ran into trouble and couldn't quite accept everything was because the British study unfortunately included sodium benzoate, and their question, which was a valid question, was how do we know it wasn't the sodium benzoate? How do we know it was really the coloring that caused all these problems? Because it was mixed colors. It wasn't individual colors. It was with this preservative. You know, now they talked again to the researchers. There was statistical evidence showing it was not the sodium benzoate, but statistics doesn't have that much weight when you're not sure, and they were not sure.
I see.
And they didn't want to go with just the statistics. They wanted more research, and that's what they've asked for, and that's what we're going to be trying to provide, is research directly related to what it is that they felt was missing.
Now, I know I'm encouraged by the fact that they at least had some experts from Feingold there to testify. That helps me.
Joy, can I just mention one thing?
Your
listeners will be very excited to hear about. Shula's testimony, both the PowerPoint and the audio portion, it's only 10 minutes long because they didn't give her a lot of time, but in that 10 minutes, she presented information that was, in this topic, extremely dramatic and extremely important. And your listeners can go online and they can hear Shula's testimony. They can see the PowerPoint, which is very, very user-friendly. And for non-scientists like myself, it's very understandable. The web address is FDA-DIES, FDA-DIES. With FDA-DIES.com.
Okay.
And it's really, if you have a minor interest, it will be very interesting. If you're really into the studies, it'll blow you away.
Okay, great. And that's Jane Hersey. She's the National Director of the Feingold Association. And we're also speaking with Shula Endokin of the, she's the Director of Research of Feingold. So, you know, ladies, I'm always trying to be solution oriented. I do rail and rant sometimes about things that are ill that we need to fix, but I also believe that there is no use of bringing up a subject if you can't offer a solution. And we did talk briefly, Jane, about making choices when you go to the store, but I want to take the time now and play a little video that you put together, and it's on your website. And it's talking about what are the funny things in the food. It doesn't have a title, but if you wanted to view this, you can go to www.feingold.org.
Right, and there's an alternative website address that's a little easier to remember. That's ADHDdiet.org. They're both the same, but Feingold's hard to spell. So if people will go to ADHDdiet.org, they can see it's just a 14-minute little film, and it will give them a good background of the program.
Okay, and we will give out more of those all at sites at the end. But right now,
great.
I wanted to play this 7-minute video that you prepared. It gives you a lot of clues and tips and tools to use to avoid some of this food. So let's go here. Let's listen to this video that you prepared, and it is on your website. Let's just listen to this for a few minutes.
Hi, my name is Jane Hersey, and I work with the nonprofit Feingold Association. We're an organization that helps people figure out whether certain things that they're eating could be contributing to a variety of problems. It may be a behavior problem, it may be a learning problem, or it could be a health problem. And we also help people find the foods that they like, but in a much healthier version than what they may already be eating. Now, I'm going to be talking about a lot of foods that I brought. I'm going to be talking about all the funny things in food, and believe me, there are a lot of funny things in food. But I'd like to start out, first of all, with a box of cherry Jell-O and ask you if you have any idea how many cherries it takes to make a box of cherry Jell-O. Well, take a look on the back, and you'll see that the first ingredient is sugar, and then gelatin, etc., and then a lot of funny names. And then right at the bottom, it has the name Red 40 and Blue 1. Red 40 and Blue 1, what on earth is that? Well, we know there are no cherries in this, so they have to get the color from something. Red 40 and Blue 1 are names for food dyes, synthetic colors. Now, these are not made from berries. They're not made from vegetables or roots or anything like that. When you see a color followed by a number, that tells you that it's made from crude oil, from petroleum. And not only that, but most of the dyes that are used in food in the United States start out in petroleum refineries in China. And they're allowed to have a lot of toxic contaminants, including heavy metals like lead, arsenic, and mercury. The good news about food dyes is that many, many of them have been banned. In fact, most of them have either been discarded by the industry or banned by the government. The bad news, however, is that there are still an awful lot of them that are in use. And typically, the majority of food dyes tend to be used in products, not just foods, but beverages, medicines, and vitamins that are designed for young children. Well, what's such a big deal about some artificial colors in food? After all, they've been around for a very long time. In fact, they've been around for more than 100 years. Well, that's true, and it's also true that children used to eat them. However, the big difference is that years ago, children ate them quite rarely, and they didn't eat them in such quantity. For example, if you go back, about 50 or 60 years, a child might get a lollipop when he went to the bank or the barber shop. Perhaps he would pig out on artificial candy, artificially colored flavored candy at Halloween or at Easter or maybe at Christmas. But there was a big difference because these children did not get these chemicals in practically everything that went in their mouth. They didn't have red, white, and blue striped toothpaste. They didn't have green mouthwash. They didn't have multicolor vitamins. They didn't have fluorescent cereal. They didn't have bubblegum flavored medicine in a neon pink when they got ear infections. And you know what? Back then, ear infections were quite rare. Very few children got them. Another thing that's very different today than many years ago is the teachers never gave out candy. The idea of a teacher giving out candy in the 1950s was just laughable. Not only that, but schools did not have vending machines lining their hallways. And another important difference is that today, the food served in school cafeterias are really, really bad. Now, I'm not talking about whether they taste good or don't taste good. I don't remember children ever liking the taste of cafeteria food. However, those Salisbury steaks and the hamburgers and all the things that they used to serve children were actually made from real food. Today, many, many cafeterias, thinking that they're saving money, use products that when you find out what they really are, they aren't food. They're foodless foods. And it's no wonder that children are having a lot of problems in school today. So if you go back many, many years, actually Jell-O goes back over 100 years. And when Jell-O was first invented, it was a combination of gelatin and fruit. Sounds pretty simple, doesn't it? Well, the problem is that gelatin that's made such as this, that's made with real fruit, is more expensive than gelatin that's made with synthetic flavor, artificial colors, etc. So the companies, not just Jell-O, but many companies, gradually found that they could save money by putting in synthetic ingredients instead of real ingredients. So there was less and less fruit in the Jell-O and more artificial flavors. Now keep in mind that the purpose of an industry, of a food manufacturer, is to cut costs, sell a lot of their product, and make a high profit. So every time they substitute artificial flavoring for real flavoring, or substitute synthetic colors for the real fruit, then they save money. Now, what's such a big deal about artificial flavors? Well, they are made from what? Anything, actually. Artificial flavors could be made from anything in the universe. And there are no rules governing what goes into a food as an artificial flavoring. So that can create a lot of problems. Most artificial flavors are made from, guess what? Petroleum. Not only are foods filled with artificial colors and flavors made from petroleum, but most of the common preservatives are also petrochemicals. Now, these go by very, very long names that are hard to pronounce. So generally, they're listed by their initials, BHA, BHT, or TBHQ. You couldn't pronounce them, and they couldn't fit them on the label, so they abbreviate them. And guess what? Another thing that comes from petroleum, all those fragrances that are being used in non-food products, the artificially scented markers and stickers the children use, they're even being put in toys, they're put in household products. Well, how can industries afford to put perfume in these things? Well, it's easy. Most fragrances today come from, guess what, petroleum. And even the expensive perfume that you got for Mother's Day doesn't come from rose petals. Most of the perfumes come from petroleum. And whether you swallow it or whether you inhale it, it's petroleum, and it can do a lot of damage to different people.
All right. That is a video that you can access. It's a YouTube video, but you can also access it at feingold.org. That was the voice of Jane Hersey. She's the National Director of Feingold Association. Excuse me. And Shula Edelkind is also joining us by phone. She is the Director of Research for Feingold. So, ladies, I wanted to start out by thanking you again for your long work in this area. And I'm reminded, as I listen to that video, I'm reminded of how many products. It's not just food anymore. And when you're doing a study and you give a kid, you know, one little dose, you're not taking into account, as you mentioned on the video, Jane, the medicine, the toothpaste, the vitamins, the lotion. There are some kids who are sensitive to these petroleum products through their skin.
Absolutely. If you look at the way a nicotine patch works, the drug gets into your system through your skin. So if it works for medicine, it will be a similar situation for colorings as well. But the good news is there are ways around all of these things. This is really what our support group does, is to find solutions to things. And sometimes these problems can seem a little bit overwhelming, but they're really not that complicated. We've got thousands of parents who have found answers. And, excuse me, we pull our information and come up with what seems to work the best.
So you can definitely get that information from the Feingold site, and we're going to give all those out again. But also, you've written several books. Two of them that I rely on a lot, Why Can't My Child Behave and Healthier Food for Busy People, we're actually offering as a premium today to help fundraise for KPFA. For a $75 pledge, you can call 1-800-439-5732 or 510-848-5732, and you can get copies of these two books that Jane has put together. They are full, chock full of information, tips, tools, strategies, where how to shop for your family, what to look for in processed food, how to actually feed yourself from whole foods and not relying on processed food. So I want to encourage people to go to the phone right now and call us at 1-800-439-5732 and say, hey, KPFA, I support the work of About Health. I support KPFA, and I believe that this information is important. But back to you, too. So what do we do now? We're waiting for the FDA to do some more studies. What does that look like? How can we influence the process, and what's our next steps?
Well, the FDA is not going to do studies they're going to wait for somebody to do them.
Oh, my goodness. That doesn't sound good.
Yeah, so we're in the process of trying to raise funds, and people who go to our website will see that there is a thermometer on the site that tells how much we've raised so far. And, of course, there's a long way to go. We've just begun. And the purpose of this is to do the studies that they want done at the FDA. Now, they want individual studies of how children react cognitively, or how, in this case, if we can do it on rats, but cognitively, to see if it makes them unable to find their way out of a maze, if it makes them stupid, if it makes them hyperactive, each individual color by itself. There have been studies on these things. There's a lot wrong with the colorings. Forget about hyperactivity, you know. There are other things wrong with the colorings. You can see by the color a variety of studies. Again, I'll give you a website. It's called diet-studies.com, and that's a page with the various studies on red, blue, you know, yellow, and those studies that have been done, they show a lot of effects that are developmental effects, that are reproductive effects. You know, these are toxicity effects. Most of them are studies on animals. That didn't impress the FDA so much because they are considering whether it has cognitive effects. So we need to do, and they want to know each individual dye. That's a little bit tricky because, you know, it may be that blue by itself is not near as dangerous as blue and red together.
Right.
And in the food, you're going to get it together. However, if you do a study on blue, then you do a study on red, then you do another study with the two together, you get an idea of what's happening, and nobody's done that.
Yeah.
So this is what we want to fund. We don't do the research ourselves. We need to. We're looking at researchers. We're discussing it, and we'll need to hopefully fund this type of research to make it extremely clear in very simple fashion. You know, I'm not talking about complicated research. I want it to be so easy even the FDA can understand it.
Good luck
with
that.
It's really going to have to be easy.
Good luck with that. But I'm encouraged that there, as I said, there's some light being shined on this. However, I want to caution both of you because I think you both are aware of how serious this is, and that we're going to be fought all the way through these studies, and that the food industry is not above doing whatever they can to sabotage this process. Don't you agree?
I totally agree, Joy, but you know, the reason why I am very encouraged is this, that when the publicity came out about the FDA studies, again and again, we saw that the media was explaining that these are petroleum-based dyes. I've been giving workshops for decades, and when I hold up that box of cherry Jell-O and ask people where the red 40 comes from and the blue 1 and all, almost nobody in the audience knows that these are petroleum. This is crude oil that they're eating. Now, as a result of the media publicity, people are seeing food dyes come from petroleum, and they're also reading that a lot of people believe that ADHD symptoms could be the result of food dyes. And so I think that when enough moms, and it's usually the moms who are aware of this and paying attention to this, when enough moms look at this information and then they watch their child and they notice, gee, you know, when he had that blue slushy, 30 minutes later, he acted wild. He was fine before it, and then after, he was just terrible. Or when he came back from the birthday party and had the red stain around his mouth and ate the fluorescent birthday cake. I think that when the moms start to pay close attention to their child's behavior and can link it with something that they were exposed to, generally it's food, then you're going to start to see more and more and more parents recognizing this. And we're already seeing that. Mm-hmm. Now, what happens when a growing number of parents recognizes that food dyes are harming their children and they understand, hopefully they'll benefit from our literature and our experience and research, but when they recognize that they have a choice in the supermarket and they start saying, well, I don't buy anything with dye, that means anything that has a color followed by a number is a no-no. If it says red 3 or yellow 5 or yellow 6, any color plus number is your tip-off. It's really simple to do. They are listed on the ingredient labels, so parents can start watching their kids, looking at the reactions, and making the connection. And I think that long before the FDA moves out of its coma and does anything, I think the parents are going to be way ahead of them.
Yeah.
And we're going to do what we can to make it as simple as possible. We show people that they don't have to give up anything they enjoy. They really don't even have to give up processed foods, because they can buy candy, they can buy mixes, they can buy whatever they want. Now, most of us kind of get away from the processed foods because we find very simple ways to make just plain wholesome food. We like the money savings of not buying a lot of processed foods.
And the packaging.
Absolutely. But I think the parents are going to lead the way, and eventually the FDA will come around to do what its job is, and that is to protect the consumer.
Yeah.
But it'll be the moms that make the changes.
Well,
we see a light now at the end of the tunnel in watching the industry newsletters, because as the companies are talking to each other and pretty much talking to themselves, they're looking for natural solutions. How can we not use these colorings? Where are the natural colorings?
Right.
Where are the natural flavorings? They're looking for them. They know that there is, whether or not they agree that there is really a need for it, they know that there is a perceived need, and after all, they have to sell their product. So as parents become more educated, they can vote with their dollars.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And I'm so excited and hopeful for that. The other thing I wanted to mention really quickly, one of the side effects of this is that oftentimes you hear parents blame sugar. And I just wanted to point this out to my audience. A lot of these dyes and preservatives come with sugar. I mean, when we give a kid a ho-ho or a Twinkie or some cake or ice cream, they have the dyes in it, but they almost always, not always, but a lot of times have sugar. And often you'll hear parents say, oh, my kid's got too much sugar. That's why he's bouncing off the walls. And I want people to check that. It's not that sugar is a good thing. Certainly processed sugar is not the best in the world. But we need to look at what else was in that sugar-packed food that might be affecting your child. And I wanted to mention and remind everyone, this doesn't only affect children. It affects adults as well.
Yes.
Lots of road rage out there.
Absolutely.
Could probably be blamed on. And how many people who may be in prison because they weren't able to control, they had compulsive behavior. Compulsive behavior is another symptom of hyperactivity, of food additives sensitivity. So we're speaking with Jane Hersey and Shula Edelkin of the Fine Gold Association. We're talking about food additives. We are offering Jane's two books, Why Can't My Child Behave? And Healthier Food for Busy People, for a $75 pledge. This is Pledge Drive at KPFA. You can call us at 510-848-5732 or 1-800-439-5732 and say, hey, KPFA, I support the work. I support the work of Dr. Lenore, who has been doing this show for more than 15 years. He comes here and volunteers his time and his space and energy to give you cutting-edge information about all sorts of health-related topics. So you can call us now and show us that you appreciate the work, that you think KPFA is important, 510-848-5732, 1-800-439-5732. Get your copies of Why Can't My Child Behave and Healthier Food for Busy People. Jane, tell us about the books. Why did you write them?
Yeah, well, I wrote the first book, Why Can't My Child Behave, really partly out of frustration, because by that time the organization had been going for a long time, and we had hoped that by educating teachers, doctors, and other professionals, that they in turn would share this information with their patients. But we were finding that there was so much reluctance on the part of professionals, first of all, to listen to parents, even though the parents had been the successful ones and done what the professionals had not been able to do. And also, they were very invested in their own belief system. And it became so frustrating to realize that these people didn't put the needs of the children first, at least in our opinion. Now, of course, there are professionals out there who are and have been wonderful, but too many of them were just not paying attention to the growing number of studies and all of this good information that we had. And so I thought, well, I want to write a book that's going to be directly written to the parent. Primarily, it's written to the mom, because in most families, she's the one who deals with this. And so I wanted a title. I chose Why Can't My Child Behave? Because we were planning to donate many, many copies to libraries. And I wanted mom, when she came into the library looking for help for her child, I wanted to see her to see a title that would resonate. And it's been an incredibly rewarding thing. I hear back from people who say, my gosh, you know, you've really turned things around for our family. And that's been absolutely wonderful. And the second book, Healthier Food for Busy People, is a very lighthearted, kind of a satirical look at all the dopey things that go on in the food industry. And I think about the scene in The Wizard of Oz where they pull the curtain back, and what they find behind the curtain is this pathetic person with a loudspeaker. And that's how I see things in the food industry. Once you understand all the gimmicks and all the smoke and mirrors that they put up, it's really not difficult to know how to work around them, to be able, within a very short time, a parent can look at a package of food and know that, you know, there's something really wrong with it. They say no artificial colors and no preservatives. Oh, that means it's got fake flavorings in it. There are all sorts of gimmicks. They'll use the word natural that doesn't have any meaning at all.
Exactly.
So the second book, Healthier Food for Busy People, was written for a couple of reasons. One was so that our members, when they run up against, you know, Aunt Tilly who wants to give the child a purple cupcake, or mother-in-law, or a teacher, or a neighbor who doesn't understand, you know, why are you making such a big fuss over this? Well, this is the book to hand to them, to explain to them why this stuff is so ridiculous, so unnecessary, and so harmful. So the Healthier Food book, to me, is kind of like a pre-K or a kindergarten introduction into nutrition. And I feel very passionately that most people, most adults who even may be very well educated, are like preschoolers when it comes to an awareness and an understanding of food additives. So it was written for that purpose. It also was written for just a kind of a fun time. One of the rules, I have 20 little rules to help you navigate the supermarket, and one that people always comment on is one of the rules that says, don't drink anything the same color blue as your toilet bowl cleaner. So I like to demystify this. I like to spill the beans and tell people the things the food industry doesn't want them to know. So that was the main purpose for this book, and it's been a lot of fun, too.
Yes, these are very good books for information, for research, to refer to them while you're in the store. I love that you've written them for lay people, for just normal, everyday people who have kids that are having problems. It's not, you don't have to have a degree to understand and access the information in there.
Absolutely. And I don't have the scientific background. When I have questions, I call Shula because he explains it to me. So at first it seemed like, you know, too bad I don't understand all this complicated science. And then as I worked more and more in Feingold, I began to realize that it really is an advantage, because if I can understand it, then anybody can understand it. So we like to take complicated things and make them as simple as possible. And, you know, when a teacher, and Shula's been a great teacher, when a teacher really understands their subject, really understands it, they can make it simple. They can make it understandable.
Yeah.
And so everything we have in Feingold, whether it's in our newsletters, our online information, books, our handbook, our food list, everything that we have is geared to be careful, precise, accurate, scientific, but also very simple.
Yeah.
And it's not, you know, these are not oxymorons. You can have it both ways. You can also have it both ways when it comes to food. You can have food that tastes great, that's good for you, and that doesn't cost as much as the other food.
Yeah.
This has been probably one of our biggest problems because people are of the mindset that you can't have it both ways.
Yeah.
And that isn't true. You can. I pay very modest prices for the food I buy, but I buy the best food. So it's like a gourmet food on a poor person's budget.
Yeah.
Why should I spend so much money on bad food? Because if you really take a hard look at some of the worst food out there, it's usually the most expensive.
Yeah.
You know, $4 for a box of cereal that's just a handful of grains,
yeah,
a whole lot of sugar, and a lot of chemicals.
We're paying for convenience is what we're paying for. A good friend of mine was complaining about having to buy the organic macaroni preparation, and I was saying to her, you know, if you bought you a couple of cups full of macaroni and a package of cheese, it would be so much cheaper. But she said to me, well, Joy, who's got time for that? And I was like, oh, my God, how long does it take to boil? But that's just our society. We want everything instant. We want it microwavable. We want it in our mouth right now. We can't even wait, you know, five minutes.
That's true. That's true. And, you know, I do make my own mac and cheese from scratch, partly because it's economical and partly because we like the flavor. But the interesting thing about Feingold is we really don't cut out processed and convenience foods. You can have the mac and cheese mix. It's just a question of buying the mix without the yellow 5 and 6.
Right.
You can eat out at fast food chains. In fact, we publish a guide, that's part of our membership package, a guide to what to choose when you go to the major fast food restaurants. Now, most people, if they start out eating really, really bad, highly processed foods, then will go to the better version of the processed foods, and then eventually they'll start to realize, you know, it's just not that hard to, instead of opening a box of a helper dinner, just boil some pasta, throw in some tomato sauce and some meat.
Right.
And
yeah.
Money.
And I hope we can get back to that as a country, that we learn to value whole processed food. And there's such marvelous meditation possibilities in cooking and spending time with your family and communing with the earth. So we speak with Jane Hersey. She's the National Director of Feingold Association. And we're also joined by, on the phone, Shula Edelkin. She's the Director of Research for Feingold. We're going to give out some websites again so you can get more information about that. But right now, I need you to stop what you're doing, stop listening to us, and go to the phone. Show us that you care about the work that goes on here. Show us that you care about health. Dr. Lenore, me, who volunteers to come in here and bring you this information, and KPFA in general. We just heard from Karen Sanders. There's so many wonderful bits of information to be found on KPFA. KPFA actually is a portal to the rest of the world. We try to be global. We try to give you information you don't normally get. We criticize our government. We criticize the FDA when they need it. We speak to power when it's necessary. If you agree with this policy, if you agree with this station's mission, if you want to help us out, go to the phone. I need five of you at least to go to the phone right now. Dial 510-848-5732. Or 1-800-439-5732. You can get copies of these wonderful books that I just referred to that Jane Hersey wrote, Why Can't My Child Behave? And Healthier Food for Busy People. They complement each other very well. They give you great information, what to look out for, how to avoid these toxic chemicals, how to eliminate petroleum from your food. And I also wanted to point out, Jane, that you mentioned to me the last time we talked that a lot of the major food processors make these exact same products in Europe, but they eliminate the food, the artificial coloring.
That's right.
Kraft, for example.
Yep, they use the natural colors. In fact, I'm looking at bags of Skittles, M&M's, Twix, Snickers, Starburst. These are all foods, candies, and we don't cut out candy. We just cut out the dye in the candy. These are all candies that have natural colorings. You know, some people have been led to believe, unfortunately, by media reports that are very inaccurate, that if we were to get rid of things like red 40 and yellow 5, that our food would be gray. Well, that's absurd. the food in Europe is not gray.
No.
What food companies would have to do, instead of using petroleum-based dyes, they would have to do what they're doing in England and the rest of Europe. They would have to use dyes that come from actual food, or sometimes from minerals, spices, vegetables, fruits, etc. They would have to put strawberries in their strawberries.
Yeah, real strawberry. Strawberry jello.
Products, etc.
They might have to put real blueberries in their blueberry pop tarts.
Oh, my gosh.
Absolutely. What a concept.
When you watch Shula's testimony to the FDA, pay attention near the end where she talks about blue number one being the FDA cautioning doctors not to put it in feeding tubes because it was killing, killing patients. FDA. So there, anything you want is out there, and when you go to stores like Trader Joe's and Whole Foods and some of the natural food stores, you can buy jelly beans that are beautiful.
Yeah, Trader Joe's has a lot of good stuff, too.
Absolutely.
All right, ladies, we're going to give out your contact information. Now, Shula, what do you think people can do to, besides coming up with a whole bunch of research dollars, how else can we move the process forward of the FDA finally trying to look at this stuff seriously?
Maybe not directly with the FDA, but the more people that pay attention to what they're buying, besides the fact that they don't want to pay money for things that are not even food because they're just getting cheated, but if they think about it and they buy the products that are made from natural foods, then the companies that make these foods will realize it's necessary. They can certainly write letters to McDonald's and say, we want you to do for our children like you're doing for British children.
Mm-hmm.
McDonald's told us when we contacted them that, yes, we'll do it when the FDA says we have to.
Uh-huh.
But they'll also do it when the American people say they have to.
So that's one thing we could do also is write our congressmen, our local congressmen, and tell them that we're interested. Okay, ladies, we're almost out of time. Let's give out these websites. Now, you have the FDA-dyes.com.
Correct. FDA-DYES.com. That will take you directly to Shula's 10-minute testimony. It's really, really, really interesting. The other website address we generally use for our website is ADHDdiet.org. And if your listeners are interested in information on improving school food, they will see a bar on the left of our website, ADHDdiet.org. They'll see a link to school food. We've got lots and lots and lots
of. You have to scroll down some. It's on the left.
Okay.
Scroll down on the left, correct.
All right, good. All right, that's going to be it for us. I wanted to thank you both for joining us today. The information that you have is so valuable. I really, really appreciate the time you're taking and all the work that you're doing to get this word out there and to get people, help people be aware and be proactive. So I'm asking all of my audience to go to the website, get as much information, and arm yourself. But thank you, ladies. I'm going to get off the phone with you and try to drum up some money for this place.
Thank you, Joy, for having us.
Thank you. That was Jane Hersey. She's the National Director of the Fine Gold Association. And we also were joined by Shula Edelkin. She is the Research Director of the Fine Gold Association. Now I want to go to business. Dr. Lenore comes in here and volunteers to put this show on every Monday for several years now, at least 15. And if you want to support the work that's being done here, call us at 1-800-439-5732 or 510-848-5732. I've left this kind of late. It's only a few minutes left. But I need you to go to the phone right now and give us whatever you can. If you don't want to buy the books, if you can't afford it, if it's too much, you can certainly put it on an installment plan. $75 comes out to $6.25 a month. Call and give us $5, $10, $20, $15, whatever you can afford. You can put it on your credit card. You can have electronic fund transfer. We can take the money out of your bank automatically. If you call, the volunteers will ask you. It only takes about 5 minutes. Please call us 1-800-439-5732 or 510-848-5732. I only see one light on the board. If people could please go to the phone now. You can also donate online, kpfa.org, if that's an easier way from you. It's a secure donation online. But this is a good way to show our physical, actual support. I don't want to do the virtual support thing. I want people to go to the phone right now and show that you care about this radio station. You care about the information you receive here at About Health. You think that it's a venerable institution and needs needs to be supported. Yes, we have issues here. Don't get me wrong. There's a lot of internal politics that causes some bad things to come out over the air. But honestly, basically, truly, this is a venerable, precious green space. This place does not get funding from any corporation. We are not beholden to anyone. We give you the truth, the unadulterated truth. We search out the world for the truth, and we bring it to you week after week, day after day, 24/7, right here, 1-800-439-5732, 510-848-5732. Call us and give what you can. Stretch it out. Put it on electronic fund transfer. Give us a one-time payment of $5 or $10. Say, or you can get a copy of Why Can't My Child Behave or Healthier Food for Busy People by Jane Hersey for a $75 pledge. I want to thank all the phone volunteers that have been there. I want to thank our food donors, Semi Freddy's, Ike's Place, and Cabot Creamy Cooperative. And I want to thank Miss M, for always being there to support us and help us. We got two callers on the line. Last time, I'm going to give out the number, 1-800-439-5732, 510-848-5732. This is Joy Moore. I've been filling in for Dr. Lenore, and he will probably be back. We know we have Fun Drive for a couple more weeks now, so I want you to stay tuned. Get the premiums that you want to. Go online if you have to, but show your support for this station. Come in and answer the phones, too. We always need people to do that. All right. I'll be back next time. Take care. Don't forget, the most important thing you have is your health. Take care of it.